Lynn and Karen Henry for the beautiful music this morning. What a blessing again. I have been so blessed with the music over these last few weeks. Our choir has always done a great job, and now we have an opportunity to hear from our choir members individually and in couples, and just what a blessing that is. And I'm so thankful, so thank them again. I want to thank Benny again too. Bless his heart, he has to come down and he takes this and records it, and so he gets to hear it twice. I don't know, maybe that's divine intervention. Maybe the good Lord's telling him he needs to hear it twice. I don't know. Maybe that's what it is. But what a blessing he is, and I'm so thankful for him being able to do that. And I do want to say something about that too. And I think most of y'all know this, and I hope I don't upset you, Benny, but I want y'all to be in prayer for Benny. He had told me this morning everything's still on schedule. He's going to be having surgery on the 11th, at Duke University Hospital. So they're going to be looking at a portion of his lung, and they're also going to be biopsying a place on his vocal cords. So we want to lift that up. We want to do more than lift that up. We want to bathe that situation. We want to bathe him in prayer, and along with him, Catherine and that family. And Lord, we just we appreciate them so much for all that they do. And I want to thank all of those who do so much to make so many things happen. And we're just so thankful. So I'm standing here in the pulpit, and you know, most of the time, I'm telling you, so I'm standing here, and I'm looking out, and I'm imagining where you guys are at. I can look around, and in my mind's eye, I see you. But I wish you could see what I could see today, standing here in the pulpit. There's a picture in the spot on the pews where you would normally be sitting. And I know we can't show that on the camera. You can't see that from the way our church camera is, but here in just a little bit, we're gonna do a little video and we'll get it out there. I don't know if it'll be on YouTube or Facebook, however, but be looking in both those places. And so you can see what I'm seeing out here in the sanctuary. And I tell you what, it's a beautiful sight. And I've just looked so forward to a time when you actually will be there. I know we're together right now. I know we're together in heart and spirit. And I know that by the power of the Holy Spirit living and working in all of us, we are together. We may be more together today than we've ever been in the history of God's church. And I'm so thankful for the opportunity to be here with you this morning. I do want to remind everybody, too, I hadn't said much about this, but Annie Armstrong is our Easter offering. I know we're a little past Easter, and that's okay, but our Annie Armstrong Easter offering, we have a goal of $2,500. There's a little sign on the door, and if we were here, you'd be able to see that. Our goal is $2,500. We're not quite there. Y'all been giving. We need to be praying about that. We're going to extend that time, but our goal is $2,500, and you know, it's for North American missions. It's what that's for. Well, you know, just because we've had to do some things different doesn't mean that there's still not work out there for our in the mission field, and they need our financial support to be able to continue in the ministry of North American missions. So please, don't forget about that, and please be sure to be praying. Ask God how He would have you to give. Our goal is $2,500, but ask God how He would have you to give for that, so that we can meet our goal. I would love for us to exceed that goal, to bust it wide open, and I know that you can do that. You guys always are very generous with your giving, and I know you'll take care of that. So don't forget that Annie Armstrong Easter offering, okay? If you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, if you turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 6, I think that's where we were last Sunday. We were in 2 Corinthians, but I want to just kind of hang in there with 2 Corinthians. We're going to be looking at chapter 6. We're going to be looking at verses 14, 15, 16, 17, right along in there. Maybe one more, just depending on how our time goes this morning. But 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and we're going to start in verse 14 and just see how far we can get here. All right, so let's look at that together, starting in verse 14. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And verse 17 says, therefore come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we ask you now that you would just open our hearts and minds, Lord, that you would, allow us to see your ideas and your thoughts in these verses this morning. Father, we pray that you would, Lord, that you would speak to us and help us as we study these passages. Lord, we pray that not only would we see them and read them, but Lord, that we would absorb them into our heart, Lord, that we would hold them there, so that on the time that we need them, Lord, that they would be readily available, Lord, that we would be able to use them for your glory and your honor. Father, I ask you now to give me clarity of thought and clarity of speech, Lord, that your word would go out unhindered from this place. And Lord, I ask you to bind Satan and set him outside, that he'd have nothing to do here. Lord, he'd have nothing to do in the homes of our families. And Lord, that he would just be bound up and set outside. Lord, that he would cause no trouble today. And Lord God, we just ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So these verses this morning. We're living in a time when connectedness is the rule of the day, right? Well, you know, all of a sudden that has hit a brick wall, right? Connectedness, being together, that has kind of come to a somewhat of a screeching halt, and now we're starting to kind of try to figure out how to stay connected in this day when we've been so connected. You know, I just can't help but think how in this time of social distancing and quarantine and all these words that we've been using and hearing here lately, how that must have affected this connectedness that we have. You know, we're so connected with our cell phones, with our computers, with our tablets, our internet. We are always connected with those around us. You know, even though we're not right here together, we're still connected. You know, modern technology is allowing us to be able to watch this video from this sanctuary, and you're not going to be here, but you're going to be somewhere else, and we're going to be together, connected through this technology. But being connected to those you love and to those who need you is one thing, but there is another kind of connected that maybe is not so good. Some of the common buzzwords you often hear today are tolerance, acceptance, openness, inclusiveness. They're words that we hear a lot. And there's a push in the world today to bring everyone together. One world, one society, one church. And let me just say this, you know, that there should be one church, and that church should be the church of Jesus Christ, God's church, the church where all believers gather together, and that we worship the one true living God. We have that one Savior, Jesus Christ. There needs to be one church. I want to remind you that God did not call his people, though, to be inclusive, but he called us to be exclusive. I think that in this time right now, we need to be reminded of all the things that's going on. We hear so much about it. You know, that word exclusive. Now, let's don't get confused. Let me not confuse you on that, because I do believe in that we need to be together as we battle this disease, this virus, and these things that are going on in our world today. We certainly need to be together as a community, as a nation, as a country, as a world, in coming up with a cure and the things that will resolve this thing that has kept us apart. And we need to be together in those things. But the fact is, we are called as a church to be different from the world, and we need to not let that line get blurred up. We don't need to let that line get confused, but we do need to be different. The church is called out to be different from the world around us. We're supposed to look different. We walk different. We talk different. And we need to act different. Of all the churches mentioned in the New Testament, the church in Corinth was the most worldly. And that's the church that Paul is talking about in these verses this morning. The church in Philippi was known for its compassion. The church in Ephesus was known for its commitment. But this church in Corinth was a worldly church, living, dwelling right in the middle of a wicked city. As a matter of fact, the city of Corinth was so vile, it was so evil, so corrupt, that to be called a Corinthian meant that you were a person of low moral standards. And sadly, there was little distinction between this church and the world around this church. And Paul is just simply letting them know that things don't have to be this way. These verses tell us everything that we need to know as well to remain separate in a connected world. Paul uses several words to make his point. The word righteousness is in our text this morning. The word righteousness has the idea of purity of life, of clean living, of doing what is pleasing to God. The idea here is that God's children are to be different from the world in the way that they conduct their lives, the way they live, the things they do. Let's look at Philippians chapter 1 and verse 27. I think it'll help us get a little bit better idea here about what Paul's talking about. It says, only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come to see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. We are not to put on the world. We are not to put on the world, but we are to put on Christ in front of the world. Romans chapter 13 and verse 14 says, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. We are to dress ourselves in the grace of Jesus Christ, in the love of Christ. Then Paul talks about, he uses the words light and dark. He's talking about light and darkness. And here we see that light and darkness can have no fellowship. They cannot live together. They cannot be in the same place. Even the tiniest bit of light has the power to push away the darkness. Have you ever experienced that, to be in a dark room and just a small light, the smallest of light would be on? And how it would push back. And the longer you're there, the more that light, it pushes back. It pushes back the darkness. And pretty soon you realize that you're not in darkness at all, but you are in the light. We are to be different because we are to live our lives according to the Word of God. Yes, that's what helps us to be different. That's what gives us our direction to be different, is the Word of God. We have a different standard of living than does the world. We are to be different. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 7 says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. And then in the Gospel of John chapter 14, looking at verse 21, it says, He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him, make known to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? And Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our homes with him. You know, one of the things with all of the stuff that we see going on in this day and time, we need to be careful. You need to be aware. You need to be in God's word so that you know what God's word says. But we need to be aware of the words of any man who would try to add to or subtract from the Word of God. That's why it's so important that we know what God's Word says. That's why I ask you on Sunday mornings, if you have your Bible, and I hope that you do, there's a reason for that. It's not some little catchy thing that I just say at the beginning of the service, but I mean it with all my heart, that if you have your Bible, and I hope that you do, that you'll open it and you'll read it and you'll know what God's Word says, so that nobody can add to it for you or take away from it for you, but you'll know the truth of what God's Word says. We must walk in the pure living Word of Almighty God. Psalm 119 and verse 9 says, how can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. Paul reminds us that we are God's possessions. That's right. We belong to the Lord. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've allowed Him to take up residence in your heart, then we belong to Him. We are His possession. My friend, let me remind you that this church is not the temple of God. You who are saved are His temple. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19 says, "Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you?" That's right. Before you were saved, he was working on you from the outside. He was pushing you and pulling you. He was working on you on the outside. But now that you're saved, now that you know Christ as your Lord and Savior, that Holy Spirit, He lives inside of you. The Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God. And you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. The things of this world do not belong in your life. And that's a tough one, isn't it? Because we look around and we see those things that seem like, well, you know, if I just had this or I just had that. And look, I struggle with those things just like you do. But the things of this world do not belong in our lives. Nor do they have a place in your worship of the Lord. We need to take those things of the world and give them back to the world, because look, that's where they're going to stay. At some time, at some point, those things are going to pass away. But your relationship in Christ and all of heaven is going to go on for eternity if you know Him as your Lord and Savior. Paul uses another word, his accord. In verse 15, he uses that word. And he's referring to being together. It's like a musicians who play the same piece of music. It's, you know, you've got different parts. You've got the woodwind section and the brass section and the percussion section and the string section and all the parts and pieces of an orchestra or a band or whatever it might be. And they play all of the pieces and the notes at the same tempo and at the same pitch. And it all goes together the same way at the same time. Just as there is accord, harmony, there is disharmony when the pianist plays a song and one thing, and then the choir sings a totally different song, then we have disharmony. It doesn't go together. It's confusing and it makes no sense. Just as there's disharmony between Jesus and everything that is evil. The whole point here is this: God's people are to be different from the world around them because they possess a new nature. That's why we're different. That's why we can be different. Because in Christ we were made a new creature, a new creation, a new nature. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away." Amen. Old things have passed away. You know what? These old things that are keeping us apart today, this old virus, it's going to pass away one day. Old things are going to pass away. Behold, all things have become new. And that's including you when you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. He wants to make you new. And then Paul says, "Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers." Well, you know, this phrase or this thought, it most oftentimes is applied to marriage. And we hear it most of the time involved in a marriage, or we talk about it in marriage counseling, or it could be part of verses in a marriage ceremony. And it's a very true statement. It is wrong to marry outside your faith if you are a believer. If you're saved, we need to be equally yoked with another believer. But there's so much more. There's a whole sermon and a whole message just in that right there. But there's so much more to this than just what we're seeing right here. It has the idea of not walking with the world. It has the idea of not walking with the world. A believer needs to be aware of all of his relationships, because you see, walking with the world often results in walking like the world. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 33 says, "Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits." We need to be so careful in this day and time. I think that's what caught my attention so much about these verses, is because we still have to be the church. We're still called to be the church. And look, it's so easy for us to get sidetracked. It's so easy for us to see about going in another direction. Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. We should refuse to walk with the world. And we are also should refuse to walk like the world. Let the world do its thing. It's going to do it anyways. Let the world do what it does. Let the world do its own thing. We who are saved are going to be different. We must be different. We're called to be different. We are called out people, and we are to be different. God says, if you will be separate from the world for my glory, then you will be in my favor. You know, I don't know about you, but I want God's favor on my life. I want God's favor on my ministry, and I want God's favor here on Macon Baptist Church. I want God's favor to be on you as an individual. I want God's favor to be on us so that we can do the most that we can do for God's glory while we have time to do it here on this earth. Maybe the question might be this morning, well, preacher, are we really expected to remain separate in this connected world? And absolutely, the answer to that is yes. We are expected to remain separate in this connected world, but we are to be separated. But I want you to understand something. We're to be separated, but we are not to be isolated. Remember Jesus? He lived in this world, and he lived a perfectly holy life. And while he led that life, at the same time, he was a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Go look that up sometime in Luke chapter 7, verse 34, and read that for yourself, okay? We are to practice contact without contamination in this world. How about that? I believe that is a word for today, for the very time that we are living in right now. We are to practice contact without contamination in this world. We are, and we have to interact. We are in this world, and we have to interact with the world around us. You know, we can't walk around in a big old bubble, never being able to have an influence on this world. We must try to reach out into this world, into this lost and dying world, while we live here in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. We are to shine as lights in the world. We cannot forget our mission. We cannot forget what God's placed us here for as his people. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 15 says, "So that you may become blameless and pure children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky." Oh my, that's my prayer for you. That's my prayer for us, that we will shine among them like stars in the sky for God's glory. Not for anything that I can do, not for anything that you can do, but for the glory of God. God's church should never be ashamed to be out of step with this world. You know, that's a good analogy. I know when I was in high school, I was in the marching band, you know, and when we were in the parade or we were on a football field, man, it was a major deal if you were out of step. You wanted to be in step. All the feet needed to come up the same amount, and you know, we even wore spats on our shoes so that your feet would kind of stand out. And the judges, when you would go to band competitions, they would look at your feet to see if all of them were up at the same time, and the right foot was up and the left foot was down, and it all went together. But for the Christian, for God's church, we should be out of step with this world, and we should never be ashamed to be out of step with this world. You and I should never be ashamed of what we are in Christ Jesus. You and I should never be ashamed of what we believe and of the conviction that we hold in our hearts for the truth of an almighty God. We should never let that slow us down. We should never let that make us ashamed. We as the church, you and I as individuals, must not forfeit the presence and the power of God so that we might gain the popularity and praise of men. Prayer. Prayer. Pray. Pray that we will walk this path of conviction for the glory of God. Conviction. Conviction. You know, in this day, in this time that we're in, it's so easy for us to be confused with things. Being connected, the line of connectedness, sometimes it gets blurred. I believe Paul has defined specifically and told us through the inspiration of God's word to Paul's heart and into his hand to write this, that we do live in a connected world, but we, the church, the saved, the redeemed of Christ, we have a responsibility. I hope that you have a conviction in your heart to be separate, to be different, to stand out. We need to do that in a kind way. You know, we don't need to go around with a ball bat beating people over the head, but we need to be loving them into conviction. We need to be loving them into the power of the Holy Spirit working and moving in their lives. You know, I think this whole connected and separate has a way of sort of being in conflict with itself, doesn't it? But I think now we know, as the church, as God's people, what we need to do, what we need to be. We can be separated, but we don't need to be isolated. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just thank you again for your word. Lord, I thank you for all that Paul had to tell us here in these verses. And Lord, again, I know it's not just Paul speaking, but it's you speaking through Paul. Lord, you use Paul in such a powerful and magnificent way, Lord, that we have the opportunity to learn from the things, Lord, that he wrote and shared. Father, we know that this is a confusing time. Lord, things that used to just kind of almost be sort of natural, we knew exactly where they went. Well, they don't go there anymore. And Lord, we're having to learn to do some things different. So Lord God, I pray you'll help us as a church, as your church, as your people, Lord, that you'll show us the way you would have us to go, the things you would have us to do. Lord, that you would help us to reach out to those, Lord, they may make fun of us, and Lord, they may talk about us. Maybe they may try to hurt us in business and in commerce and in working and those kind of things. Lord, they may try to push us away, but Lord God, through your strength and your power, Lord, we have to reach out into this lost and dying world. Help us to be that church that you would have us to be. Lord, help us to be different. Lord, help us to be that lighthouse that shines out. Lord God, I pray that as folks ride by Macon Baptist Church, that they would say, you know, there's that church. I see something in those people, and they just look different. They sound different. They walk different. Wonder what it is that makes them that way. And then, Lord, give us the opportunity as a church to be able to tell them that Jesus Christ living in me makes me different. That's why I'm different. And Lord, we just ask that you would allow the Holy Spirit to touch a heart that is not saved. Lord, there may be one listening or watching this morning who doesn't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Father God, if that is the case, Lord, I pray that you would put someone in that person's path at this very moment, that they would be able to tell them of the love and the grace of Jesus, the saving power of a redeeming Christ. Lord, I pray that they wouldn't have to draw another single breath not knowing salvation in their lives. Father, I pray for that one that maybe has been holding back. Lord, maybe they have been a little timid. Maybe they've been ashamed even of proclaiming all that you've done for them because, Lord, of ridicule, because of persecution, Lord, because of being hurt. Lord God, I pray you'll give them a power and a strength and a courage like they've never known before. And Lord, help us to be the church that you would have us to be. Lord, we come to you now. Lord, we ask you to help us in the places where we're weak. Lord, help us to be strong for you. And Lord God, we ask these things in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the world and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God has.